Okay, so while Julia's setting up, I will introduce her. Heberle. So Julia Heberle, professor of psychology, actually child psychology at Albright College. She was one of the faculty members who received a stipend to develop courses at our partner colleges. And this was this a spring course or a fall course? And she and I met over the summer, and she had these great dreams, you know, things she was going to do and exciting plans. And when I contacted her and said, "Hey, I saw you were coming, you want to give a talk?" She's like, "Oh, but I didn't do everything, and I fell short." And I said, "That's fine, because I think one of the things that kind of comes out of this is, if you're starting this, you know, getting a sense of how much work is involved and what is the right thing to bite off, right?" So Julia's going to absolutely give us feedback on
that. I'm also going to cheat terribly. I'm just going to cheat and play to your emotions by showing you videos of cute children. Which kind of comes around to the point of what we're doing with blended learning and students anyway. We're trying to trick them into enjoying learning and trick them into getting on their Moodle site and trick them into actually being on their computers. So that's kind of the attitude that I took with some of this. But I teach a course in child development. It's a required course for our psychology majors and also for a lot of our education majors. And for many, many years, I've done it as a very straight up sage on the stage. Oh, well, I think that's highly complimentary to me. That phrase just makes me laugh. Talking head on the stage with a very good textbook that's got a lot of research basis to it. And then in recent years, I adopted my development lab. Some of you might be familiar with that. That's a prefab program from the publisher that allows the students to enroll in a class where they can pre-test themselves before exams, do a lot of practice testing, and it comes with some activities. So unbeknownst to me, I was already doing blended learning years before that phrase came in, just because I was using this kind of assessment tool for them, not grading it. Again, low stakes. They got extra credit for doing it. It was so low stakes. But it was designed to help them get ready for exams. So I was trying to get them to do that kind of thing outside of class. And then Moodle came into our lives. We had Blackboard first, and that was mostly used for grading and putting up some documents. But then Moodle came in, and I saw a lot more potential for uses for things. And it was partly a function of my learning. So what you're seeing today is very, very tiny, little piece of what I did for child development. I had great plans, as Jenny said. I had great hopes for Salon. Some of you were here the last time and knew about what Salon could do. You can put up documents and have students tag it and mark it so that not only you can see what they're doing, but that they can see what the other is doing. A lot of electronic textbooks, ebooks these days, come with the student's ability to mark up their own book and be all by themselves with it. So one of my great hopes for doing blended learning, I'm kind of telling you what I didn't do before I tell you what I did do, was to have the textbook up on Moodle, up on Salon, to have the chapters up so students could mark it and I could see what they didn't understand. Well, can you guess why that didn't work?
Legal technology.
Copyright. Yeah. Copyright. The publishers wouldn't provide the chapters. Mm-hmm. I asked two different publishers. I said, "I'll do it only after they bought the book. I promise. They wouldn't provide it. So I had to give up on that idea. So my next idea was to do what I've done here, which was to have as my goals, I want students exposed to children. Believe it or not, college students, unless they're younger sibs, don't hang around with babies very much. College students who do hang around with babies either have them because their life has changed unexpectedly or because their parents' life changed unexpectedly in a big way. But they don't get to hang around little babies very often very much. And so they may think that they're kind of cute, and they think they may have funny ideas about them. They have actually really no idea about what they're like and how they change and how fast they change. So one of my goals was to have them have more exposure to children. Now, of course, I can't bring kids into the classroom and I can't take them to the daycare center for ethical and logistical issues with a 35-student class, 35 students. So I figured I'm going to bring them by way of video. That's all nice to bring them by way of video. So that was one of my goals, was to have them look at children. My other goal was to have students make contact with materials on Moodle. they seem to think, yeah, Moodle's there, and not all my professors use it, and so, yeah, you use it, that's nice, but do I have to go there? Well, yes, you have to go there, and not just for the syllabus. So I wanted them to have a reason to go to the Moodle site regularly outside of me using it in class. I also wanted students to engage in critical thinking, oh my gosh, outside of class. And then, in fact, my final point of luring them into learning, conning them, tricking them into learning. It's kind of like the Mary Poppins statement. Children tricked you into taking them on an outing, they were tricked to do something right. So I'm luring them into learning. So the feature of Moodle that I was using, and not very well because I didn't have Jennifer except a little bit, and I was embarrassed to asking for help. So what you're seeing is a very rudimentary use of this feature of Moodle, which is, again, of the two categories, it's one of those menu options you can choose either as an assignment or an activity. This would be an activity. So using Moodle lessons. And you can tell my technology is pretty inept because I don't think this link is going to work for me, what I want to do. So I'm going to switch back out to go to my Moodle course. So I wanted to show you what the students actually see on my Moodle course, what they get. I was just going back to last spring, our very eventful spring, our hurricane, missing classes, all right, closed. So the lessons that show up, for those of you who haven't used them, this is what it looks like for the students, a little funny marker. I thought I'd give them a little warm-up, give myself a little warm-up, and since my syllabus is posted as well, I thought I'd give them a carrot. I always gave them points for doing the Moodle lessons. They had to have something. And a low stakes grading again. So here's their first test. Syllabus reading. Did you read the syllabus? We have a question on our course evaluations that says, did the teacher provide a syllabus? I've had students answer no to that, so it's a little infuriating. So there's my welcoming face and a basic question. And it will be scored. So where is my office? So you can see what happens when a student puts me somewhere that I don't want to be, even though we think psychology is a science. And I say, it's in Science Hall, and then I click Submit. It says, no, not quite. Would you like to try again? You can customize these comments yourself, make them meaner or nicer. I choose nice most of the time, so I said not quite, not absolutely no way in hell. Would they ever let a psychologist in the science building? We'd like to be there sometimes. So they can, this option I know is important for other kinds of assessments. Yes, I'd like to try again. No, I just want to go on to the next question. That would probably have some value, but not in this case. So yes, I'd like to try again. Takes you back. And in fact, I'm in a building called Teal Hall, and they get the right answer, yes, and they hit a continue button. So you can see this is deadly dull stuff. This is just basic getting them to learn how to look and click and find their way through buttons that are not very big, buttons that are not shiny. They have to put some effort into this. So what day does Dr. Heberle have office hours? This is always helpful too. Some of them say, no, she didn't have office hours. But in fact, I had them every Tuesday and Thursday. And that's yes. I could have said cheers, that's great. But I just was keeping it simple, yes. What time? Yeah, anytime you want to meet with her, no. I don't think I got funny on that one. So this is not quite. So this is a very simplistic kind of lesson. And from my experience, it was the kind of format that worked best when you had objective, multiple choice style kinds of questions. And as it turns out, that wasn't really what I was aiming for with the kinds of things I wanted to do, but I tried a variety of ways to try to make it work for me with what I was after. But this was just their way of introducing. So anytime you want to meet with her, no, none of that. So we'll just pick a wrong answer.
Why lesson versus quiz?
Pardon me?
Why lessons versus quiz for this?
Partly, I guess, because of the other things I wanted to do in terms of showing them the right answers and the skip patterns, I think, moving through. So a quiz is pretty much a straight up assessment. You're going to do 10 questions, you're going to get 9 out of 10 right. Mm-hmm. And this allows you to move around and move through. And you just keep nodding like that and I'll feel more confident. Stuff I'm going to do. So that was the syllabus reading. And it does give them a final score at the end and it does get fed into the grade book. Mine were being done just mostly completed, not completed. You got your 10 points, you're going to get your 10 points. So what kinds of things was I interested in doing? Let's see if it makes sense to go back here yet. For looking at children, for my goal of looking at children, I was using videos, and I wanted them to answer a question about the video. Sometimes it worked out okay to have it be multiple choice, but as I said before, sometimes that wasn't quite the right format. But what I really discovered for, and it's not a discovery, it's just a realization, is that you want them to have immediate feedback. You don't want them to write a whole pile of stuff and then not get anything from you. But at the same time, this idea of getting from me, the class of 35, it wasn't going to happen, oh, I'm going to go look and see what they answered and write exactly a personalized answer back. The whole point of this is not to make me work more all the time. The whole point is to give them something of value that they get some feedback on that I have set up ahead of time as best I can. And that's really the challenge of this for me, was getting that feedback correct enough in response and have some connection to what they wrote. Now, if a student puts in XXX, OOO, yeah, they love me, they want to hug me, but they haven't answered the question, they would still get the same feedback. So there's weakness there. But most of them tried, most of them did. So sometimes multiple choice with immediate feedback, some are reflection, list everything, and the feedback was just, I looked at it as an additional opportunity for them to reflect. So they think and they see the video and they reflect and they write something and then they see what I wrote in return. It's an additional opportunity to reflect, not necessarily just a, ooh, I got it right kind of thing. So what kinds of things was I doing with them? Let's go back to the, sorry for the back and forth, but this is where I get cheap. You kind of see the links through. I'm going to show you a example of a video. Where is the? We're in Piaget, and okay. I hope I'm not sure this one needs sound, but I don't realize that. I don't know if I checked that I have sound. Just go see. So the link, they have to click on it, watch the video. So it opens up this window. They can see where to go, where to click, and they can see there's a question coming. Now, this isn't the best way to design necessarily Moodle. Sometimes you just want a link with the video, but I was losing my, from each time that I did one of these, I would forget what I had done the time before. So they ended up being a little bit different. As long as it worked, I was good. As long as there was an arrow for them to click on, it was good. See, you guys are cheap. This is exactly what I was aiming for. I want students to have that reaction. I want them to enjoy it. But I don't just want to be showing them videos of cute babies. I want them to be engaged in thinking about what they've seen. So you all might be familiar with what this video is demonstrating. Anybody? Object permanence in babies. That when you put a barrier between that baby and the interesting object, the baby looks away, shows some other way that they have moved on. Piaget had a lot of things to say about that. So this is a central concept in the chapter on cognitive development in my child development textbook. Central concept, they get to see it. What I want them to do is not go on to all the other cool things that you get. I love part of this is that it leads them on to further videos that are not in Moodle, but they're usually linked and usually good. They're usually not about sex, which is helpful. So they can choose to watch the video again by using YouTube's function, or they can go back to the lesson. And now they say, how old is that baby? Now, if they've read the book at that point, they realize, I know he talked about object permanence, and I know they get it by 18 months, but what the heck? oh, I need to go back. So the reflection might be them going back to the book to try to figure something out. They have it, ebook or hard copy otherwise. Or they might just say, I'm just going to guess. Now, the right answer for this baby is a very young baby, less than 4 months old. And yes, that was right. Continue. I don't like the fact that on my stupid little paving stone computer, I have to keep moving things down to see and get the immediate feedback. I know a lot of them have more expensive computers than I do. So I want them to describe what they saw in the video. They're going to write a lot in there, if they're doing their job right, about object permanence, the things that you just said, about why it is that baby's 4 months old and not 8 and not 12. And that's going to lead them, I hope, to think more about what are the little sub-stages that Piaget put in there in that first 18 months. But this is mostly, this is again, the weakness. I want them to write and work, but I do not want to read and give feedback. But I want them to engage in that active reflection. So I get the XXX, oh, love you, in order to move on. And then I give them what you should have said. So you should have said something about the baby watching the plastic keys being wiggled, looking at the keys. I want them to actually describe what they saw. I don't want them to say, oh, that's Piaget. I want them to look at the children and say what they saw. So again, when they're reading this for me, they get that reflective push. To say, this is what you should have been thinking about. You should have noticed the baby looked away as soon as the barrier was put in front of the keys. You might say the baby can't do much beyond look or not look, maybe a little hand wiggling. Maybe the baby was also looking for something else to look at. The barrier is not very interesting. So those are things that just give them an idea, and if you clicked on any one of these, you see my loss of ability with Moodle in terms of where I was supposed to end this lesson. So when we talk about next steps, it's they had to click on each of those bars, but they're not getting anything for it. They just have to get to be smart rats and go click on the last bar. Yes?
Quick question about the feedback. I saw you had, like, four longer buttons. Do you have a word limit? I don't know.
I don't know. No. I promise you, don't ask me too many questions about Moodle lesson. I'm just going to point right back to Jennifer. This truly, truly is a first effort. So I asked them a question. Who would have something to say about this baby's behavior? What theorists made much of babies not looking in an object that goes out of sight? Very basic answer, Piaget is correct. And so again, I was trying to get them doing some reflection, some open writing, thinking, and it's very simple. It's very little. It's one tiny little video. So for that particular chapter, that particular unit, this would be one of what I envisioned for myself when I have extra time is five more. One for conservation of quantity, all the wonderful basic Piaget stuff, and maybe a little bit of video of people talking out loud for Vygotsky. But so there's a world of trouble you can get into using that kind of approach. But I'm sorry for the specificity. I just wanted you to see what it looks like to try to do something very, very simple with big goals. So for critical thinking, I brought them back to some textbook materials. So these are things they're looking at. They're not videos. They're looking at something in their textbook, and it might be a sidebar. You know, we have these beautiful $165 textbooks that have all these bells and whistles that are not electronic. And so that I was trying to bring some of that back into the electronic world for them. So I had a video on infant mortality, not a video, a little slide from the book on infant mortality rates and asking them questions about why it is that the U.S. is so high. Why do our babies die when we have such great medical care and so on. And this is an example of a video that, not a video, I keep saying that, of a slide that goes early in the class. Mice. So it's extremely simple. It just puts the slide from the textbook. Now this I didn't seem to have a problem with because they provide me with PowerPoints And this would be one of my PowerPoint slides. So I can steal anything I want from PowerPoints and put it up in Moodle, but not the book chapter itself. So that just shows them the information, asks them to look at all those countries. And again, going down, take a good look at where the United States is located. Think about the countries that have a lower and a higher rate. So look at the whole thing. Don't just find the US, but look at the other countries that might surprise you that are better than we are, they're worse than we are. They now know how to press that bar, being good rats, that gets them somewhere. What factors can you think of that put the United States, country that spends more per capita on health coverage, country that claims that children are its national treasure, one of the highest rates for infant mortality? So again, they think about that and write and reflect and submit. None of them did kisses and hugs. They all wrote me something. That's the beauty of this blended learning that Jennifer points out, is that when they know you're looking, they're not going to try to insult you most of the time. So they want to do that work. So I tell them things that they might have thought about. So they've reflected, they've written, this is an example. Now they get my reflections and remind them of what they should have been thinking about. And again, I don't know the answer to how long you can type in this bar. But so think about any other factors. Remembering, we're not just looking for the many reasons. This is critical thinking. Go beyond what I've told you. Take the next step and say, what else could you possibly think would make a difference for baby's mortality? Go to the next step, put some other questions in, or things that you would think would, you would want to know about in. And I'm getting less affectionate as I go. And the complexity of factors that interact, this might extend the idea that everybody has to know enough to go to doctors. It might not be that healthcare is so bad. It may just be that we don't have enough education about getting your own healthcare taken care of, but we don't know enough biology, for example, about development. And then I compliment them all on what they've learned about prenatal development, so they all know that they will be going and getting prenatal care when they're pregnant. Yes?
You said that they don't want not to insult you when they know that you are looking. But you said the primary feature of these comments is so that you don't have to look. So how do you give them the impression that you are looking when you are not?
I comment on them. I do actually look, but I don't look too great.
I see. Okay.
So I'm very curious. I'm a curious rat. I can't help it. I don't look and see what they said, but I don't look too great. And that's mostly what I mean. So no, I comment on what they say. I say, oh, you said something really interesting.
You comment in lecture or
in lecture? Yeah. So they get that I think went back to an earlier point, when students really enjoy it when you comment on what they said and you bring them into the classroom and connect them like that. So that was another example. This one would have been good for Salon. Again, I'm really planning on using Salon. I just couldn't use it the way I wanted to this time around, but for research ethics, and so this is teaching them research methods. This comes from a horrible monograph that I found published in the 40s at the University of Virginia. A professor and his wife took two twin babies from a mother who couldn't care for them and raised them in isolation in a room in their house to see what the effects of isolation would be on babies' development. Wow. 1940 something could have been just as good as the Nazis. It was wonderful to find this and to show students that it's not that far long ago that we really were pretty awful. So the infant development under conditions of restricted practice and minimal social stimulation. So make them take that one little sentence and think about it and say, what does that imply? What does this title suggest that you're going to read in this paper? So again, this is a more reflective kind of lesson. But I was getting worried about not giving them enough feedback, so I decided to make up my own wrong answers. That's why I hate making up multiple choice questions, because I have to think about things wrongly 3/4 of the time and end up feeling I don't know anything. So I gave them some options. To the infants were not able to practice actions due to their medical condition. Infants are tied up and cannot practice actions. No, even these people were not that rotten. Infants were not interested in practicing actions. Infants were not being stimulated to practice actions. So I'm giving them some nonsense, but I'm also trying to get them to think about what this could be bringing. It's a lesson in ethics, in research ethics. So it's designed to focus them, give them something more than just, yeah, thou shalt not be mean to participants. And I was going back to, I really need to give them specific feedback.
and tell them right or wrong for some very obvious things, right or wrong. So yes, that's right. They were not being stimulated to practice actions. What does the phrase minimal social stimulation suggest to you? Again, giving them real options instead of just letting them write. So I was bouncing back and forth in my attempts to do this between really setting things up as objective and really setting things up to let them be reflective and get reflection back from me. It's two different ways of using this kind of assignment. I haven't shown you nearly enough cute babies. That's not fair. So we've had critical thinking as ways of getting different kinds of feedbacks. Another video for research methods, I asked them to watch a video. I asked them to do one of the worst kinds of child development research there is ever in the whole wide world, transcribing child speech. You want tedious. So transcribe what the children say. It introduces students to the world of research, especially for language, with a particularly heinous method that's extremely important. You can't do without it. You have to have transcription. And again, this is a case where there's not an absolute right answer given the task. The students do get feedback. And the transcripts, the answers to the suggestions for thinking at the beginning. So let me take you back. The speed of Moodle. What you do is a reflex one. What do you see was our baby with the keys, intelligence testing. You can guess that one was pretty much a diatribe. Here we go with language transcription. I'm going to turn my volume up as far as I can because I don't think I have that sound on anything except this computer. Argument. I asked them some questions generally about language. What makes this a conversation and an argument? What's the approximate age of the children besides what they say to each other? I mean, she's asserting you're four, I'm not, or I'm four, you're not. What's the biggest word? So they look at the individual things that the children say. What's the most complex in terms of syntax, the most complicated sentence, not just the longest one? So they have to actually think about some of the context that they've been, if they've read the chapter, they'll recognize why some of these questions are being asked. So those are the things that they're asked to think about. And then I ask them to do the impossible. I say, transcribe this conversation as accurately as possible. It's probably about the time they rip their hair out and say they've had enough. Watch out is harder than it looks. Try labeling the kids child one, child two, girl and boy, so you can kind of keep track of who's doing what. I don't tell them the obvious. Get your paper pencil out and do it first and then. But I also, you know, you can go back to the tape as much as you want and then they'll realize, oh dear, I have to go back to the tape lots and lots. I can't remember. This is a very simple conversation, but it's very hard to figure out who said what and why. So they do that. Down to 1x, 1o. And then they get very explicit feedback. I put the transcription up for them. So they can check theirs against what's here. And You'll keep me until you give it your best. And I put markers in as, look, here's past tense irregular, that's pretty complex. Said and first temporal marking, that's pretty complicated idea. You be quiet now, another good complex one, four words plus temporal marking. It's drying it out for you. This is a passionate argument. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden it's being dried right out into this desiccated language kind of conversation. And boy, one of the students said it was, he was saying bitching. He was saying messing. We got all kinds of interesting discussion going on how to transcribe and what a child is likely to say. Longest, most complicated, I'm going to tell your mom. And that leads to great discussions about how you actually accurately transcribe what you might have written out there was, I am going to tell your mom, and that is not what she said. So how do you judge complexity? So it led to some very interesting conversations. Again, this is something they do outside of class, but then we can bring it back in to class if we choose, because I can refer to it then, say, you did this, you know this, what did you think about that? Without having to do it as a class activity. So for the blended portion of this is a little odd, but they are being given incentive to go hang around on the computer. The incentive is sometimes something kind of awful, like the ethics one. Sometimes the incentive is kind of wonderful, going and watching kid videos instead of cat videos endlessly on YouTube. And they're getting feedback. They are getting something that they can use, something that helps with some very important concepts in the class that they will be tested on. So hopefully it's a slice of life that I'm going to be able to expand on. The things that I want to do more of, it's kind of more of the same. So for me, what the students learn, that's a big question I didn't assess. I didn't assess any beyond what you might have asked them for specifically that got blended in with everybody else's stuff. My evaluations didn't go down. I suppose that's something good. They thought I was okay. They seemed to enjoy the lessons, no formal assessment. They all completed the lessons, that much I know. Class of 35, everybody did them. They were worth points. You had to do something, and they weren't just filling in fluff X's and O's. So points for giving them a carrot, it mattered. And it helps get them to do what you want them to do. What did I learn? I'm not looking for more work. Feedback has to be self-contained. I do get curious. I do go look so that I know how they're responding, but I don't want to have to do that to grade. But I want them to have feedback. I want them to have a reason to feel like they're being interacted with during that time. They still need rewards for doing these lessons. They need those carrots and points. Feedback and points in this case were all or none. You did it, you got the points. It wasn't graded feedback in terms of a 8 out of 10 or a 9 out of 10. The next step could be more refined feedback in terms of points, if I could figure out how to do that without making more work for myself. And my next step's more of each of those kinds of videos. You can see there are about only 8 or 10 of them interspersed throughout a 15-week semester. I can do a lot better than that in each of those categories now that I kind of know what I'm doing.
How did you find them? What was your general strategy?
Oh, I told you I'm a cheap person. I look for things that are going to entertain people. The children are kind of easy. So YouTube makes it very easy to search. So my great irony is I thought our website was down for Albright right this morning when I was checking my presentation. I wouldn't have been able to get to this and show it to you if it were down. So in doing that, I was going back to where did I find those original videos. YouTube put in put in object permanence. You will find everybody's psych project has put up something. Doctors put things up. There's another one in here on reflexes. People love to post videos of what babies can do. Because I have been teaching this forever, I know what I want them to see. So I could search YouTube for that. And there's just a wealth of wonderful stuff out there. So that's how I. Yes.
As far as the content in your course, how has this changed? I guess what I'm wondering is, you mentioned that you might have done something like this in class, now they're doing it out of class potentially. Do the students now have more work to do? Are you replacing things that you would have done?
The ultimate blended question. I'm not sure I know the answer to that, because I think I'm doing I've tried very hard over the years to make my class more not entertainment, that's a bad word to use, but more enjoyable and interesting and drawing them in, again, tricking them into learning, by not talking as much and showing them things while I'm in class as well. So this is in some ways very similar outside of class without me. So I'm still doing, I guess if you looked at the, week by week structure of my stuff, I have those lessons, but I also have a video clip on adoption. I have a video clip on twinning, twin information. I put these things up for myself so that as I'm lecturing, I can interrupt myself or something good. In terms of student work, this was a very minimal addition to their outside of class work, but I hoped with more maximum value for their learning, not so much work as an opportunity. So I guess my answer to your question would be, it didn't change a whole lot of what I do inside of class. I'm still primarily talking to 30 to 35 students, occasionally showing them something entertaining and getting them to talk about it with themselves. So my in-class stuff has not changed that much, but I'm hoping to make the out-of-class stuff more than just reading the book and reviewing their notes.
So that's my next. That's the other class.
That's very nice.
Each one of those things.